I'm Dr. Sabrina Falkia from Sharpe-Rees Staley Medical Group. I've been with Sharpe-Rees Staley. I'm going on my 16th year, and I'm really excited to be here with you to really optimize and choose wellness. So we're going to talk about how to do that, especially with so much going on in our lives right now, to really figure out what you can do on a day-to-day to optimize your health. So we're going to go into the five pillars of wellness and realizing that if we touch base on these five pillars on a day-to-day basis, it really can make a huge difference as far as helping you stay grounded, decrease anxiety, optimize your immune system. So we're going to dive deep into the food aspect of it. So after we talk about the pillars in general, I'm going to go into my specialty, which is actually culinary medicine. So we're going to talk more about what that is and what that can look like when you grocery shop, when you go home and make meals, when you're choosing to eat out or bring food into your home. So the five pillars, to start off with what they are. So essentially we have eating, moving, connecting, breathing, and sleeping. So when we think about food, and again, a reminder, we're going to go really deep into this one later on in today's conversation, is really the broad strokes is making sure that we're eating real food. So essentially food that if you look at the ingredient label, you know what those ingredients are, to really move away from processed food. And we're going to also talk about what does processed food even mean? And also decreasing, we think of the kind of the three food tastes that are really addictive, and it's fat, sugar, and salt. So really finding ways to start having control over how much we're taking in, because a lot of times, especially food that we buy outside, we don't even know or think about that it's filled with these three ingredients because they have addictive qualities for our palate, and to move away from that towards more real food. The second one is moving your body. So getting your heart rate up for at least 30 minutes most days of the week. So what does that look like? One of the things I like to think is a lot of people say their usual way of moving their body is not available. So if gyms are closed, or if it's too hot out, or if we now have kids at home and we can't do our regular activities, to remember again, we're not going for A+ here, we're going for how can you optimize your body in the parameters that we currently have. So ideally, you want to move your body 30 minutes a day, and that can look like going on a walk with your face covering on and just getting some movement in. And if it's on the hotter months of the year, thinking about what time of day you do that. You can do it alone if that's a luxury you can have, or do it as a family. And if you can't leave the house, how about dancing like nobody's watching, or have a family dance party, or just thinking about moving your body and remembering you don't have to wear special clothes. You don't have to have sporty spice clothes on or tennis shoes, just sensible shoes that can get you moving. And then 2 days a week, you also want to add strength training, because we want to optimize our bone health as well. So using our major muscles of our upper body and our lower body really helps to optimize that. And again, it doesn't have to be weights at a gym. You could do wall push-ups, you could do planks, you could do heavy gardening. So really keeping it simple and being kind to yourself. So as we go through these pillars, my goal for you is to realize self-kindness to be the overlying piece, and to really touch base on these pretty much every day of the week, rather than saying, you know what, I'm going to move 2 hours on Saturday and not do anything during the week. You're much better off even walking around the block once every day than holding everything until the weekend. So the next one is connecting. And what does that mean, especially right now when the way we normally connect with people looks very different? So talking and figuring out a way, how does it feel for you to fill your bucket? What way of connecting works for you? If it's phone calls or Zoom or FaceTime or even social media, but we're going to talk a little bit about being cautious with that as well. And one of the things I've actually loved is going back to writing real letters and just sitting down and waking up in the morning as I'm having my cup of coffee and thinking about somebody that's been popping into my head and just writing them a letter and then taking that walk. So that gets my movement in of walking to the mailbox and knowing that in a few days that person is going to get a little piece of love in their mailbox, which especially these days we often don't get in our mailboxes. So when we think about connecting, a lot of it is surrounding yourself with people that really increase your self-esteem and really make you feel fully alive. And the yang of that is knowing when to disconnect. And that's one of the things that we often feel like we need to be ultra-informed, and be, again, between social media and the news, to realize we need to be aware, and again, with that self-kindness of knowing, if I stay on social media too long, how do I feel afterwards? Do I feel energized that I caught up with friends? Or do I feel like I'm comparing my lives to theirs? Or do I feel like now I've gone in these circles about hearing what's going on in the world and I'm just in a really negative place? So that's the yin-yang, about connecting in ways that feel really good and fill our bucket, and also knowing when to disconnect. So if we want to be aware of what's going on, knowing when is the best time for me to do that. So I know if I watch the news or if I get on social media right before I go to bed, that's what's going to be in my head as I'm trying to relax, which is going to affect my sleep. So thinking, I'm much for myself. Okay, I do better during the day. How about for you? What's the best time for you? And as we talk about these, I would love for you to think about this after this lecture and after we have this conversation, of just sitting with the information that we're covering and sit with it, see what feels right to you, and then see where your starting point can be. And again, with this, realizing that as a household, we're often living on top of each other much more than we ever have. And if we have the luxury of having two parents in a household, if we have children, of having that conversation with our partner and saying, what is a way that I can help you to have some alone time? And maybe just shutting a door and going in another room for a little while, watching mindless TV, going on a walk by yourself, of giving each other that space, because often we don't need as much as we think we do. We often miss vacations right now. We're really getting away for a tropical vacation. And we forget that sometimes just sitting with a warm drink and just being surrounded under a tree, sitting under a tree can really, simple things like that can really help us. The next one is breathing and thinking about being mindful or in that space of where you're at. Some people think of this as meditation. Some people think of it as really being in the zone. So really thinking about what is an activity that when you're doing it, you're not thinking about your to-do list. You're not thinking about what's going on in the world around you. This is a time for you to just be with what you love. And for that, when we think of it as meditation or breathing specifically, there's a really simple way of thinking about something we call the rule of fours. So just sitting in a comfortable place and putting your hand on your lower stomach and taking a deep breath in, counting for four in your head, holding it for 4 seconds, and then exhaling for four, and then doing that four times. And I've had the experience, my work at Sharpe Steele is in primary care, and I've had patients' blood pressure go down 20 points by doing this. So we take a blood pressure, it's a little bit high. We take that time to breathe together, and I breathe with them. It's a great pause for me as well. And then afterwards, their blood pressure can come down. And it's pretty significant if we think of how we can do that and do these pauses at different times of the day, or also if we feel like we're just about to lose our patience with our child or with our spouse or with ourselves or with something related to work, just giving yourself that time out. And the rule of fours kind of gives you some guidance on how to do that. And for other people, it could look totally different. It could be, again, that dancing like no one's watching. It could be playing an instrument. It could be methodically chopping vegetables. It could be sitting under a tree for a little while. It doesn't have to fill a rule book. Some people feel really uncomfortable with the idea of meditation or feel daunted by it or something that doesn't interest them. And to realize it doesn't have to be that to be a space for breathing and being in the moment. Then sleeping. This picture always cracks me up, because if any of you out there have had children, this is the beauty of children sleeping, but there's often lots of gaps in sleep and not sleeping through the night. Our goal is to be able to create a space where we can have restful sleep and to acknowledge how many hours of sleep do you need to feel rested. Most people need between 7 and 9 hours. I'm a 9-hour person, and even though it may be inconvenient as far as having less hours during the day to fit things in, that's the reality. And I know that, and studies show that if you get that adequate sleep, you're gonna make better choices with what you choose to eat, with what your patience level is, with being able to do things that are mindful and using our time in an appropriate way where you're getting things done rather than just kind of looping around to do tasks that aren't actually getting accomplished. So what are ways to do that, to get this space where you're really getting the best sleep possible? One of the ways is to create an environment. There's kind of two parts of it. There's creating what we call sleep hygiene, of making sure, like I mentioned, being careful about watching the news or reading tasks for work right before bed, because that's where our mind is then going. So creating a space where our bedroom really ideally doesn't have any screens. It's actually better if you read a book, a real book, rather than off a screen. And also giving yourself at least half an hour bridge between when you know you want to have lights out and starting to fall asleep. So starting half an hour prior to that to start putting the lights down. Some people like to take a shower to just give your body that signal, okay, we're transitioning towards bedtime. Why? Why do we need such good sleep? A lot of the times that we think about sleep, so it's not just to feel rested, it makes a huge difference as far as overall health. So it helps our heart rate, it boosts our immune system, it improves our levels of anxiety, also decreases levels of depression. It reduces stress levels, which again goes along with anxiety, and it helps improve our memory. Again, we've covered a lot of these, but really thinking about the sleep hygiene aspect. So aiming for about 8 hours, again, that 7 to 9 hours, and keeping the same schedule. And this can be really tricky because we tend to keep one schedule on work days, and then weekend comes around and we kind of switch our schedule around, stay up really late, sleep in late on weekends, but then it makes it really hard the next Monday morning because we're now having a hard time getting up and having that rest that we need. So really trying to keep the same wake time and going to sleep time even on the weekends. And then again, creating an environment that really optimizes your sleep space. These can't be emphasized enough, of avoiding watching TV right before bed and ideally not having a TV in the bedroom at all. Also avoiding large meals and alcohol, especially near bedtime, because if we're digesting, that's going to affect our quality of sleep. Also being careful with caffeine. Some people can have caffeine really close to bedtime and still fall asleep. Other people, if they have any coffee after 10 a.m., will notice that their sleep is affected. And it's not just from coffee, it's any caffeinated beverages, even things like green tea or matcha, which are becoming much more common to drink different beverages with those. Those have caffeine in it too. Less than coffee, but they still have caffeine in them. And then also, like I said, that half an hour before bed of thinking of some way to start relaxing our body. One of the things I love to incorporate with people, especially as we're standing and sitting in front of screens a lot and really spending so much time in our house, is to doing what I call the two-song stretch. So putting on music that you enjoy, getting on the ground at home, and just getting out kind of the kinks of the day and feeling where you might feel tighter that day or another. So not only is it good for your body, but it's also a really good way to tune in with where you're feeling areas of stress. So now we're going to transition to focusing in on the food aspect of it. So I'm going to switch here from sports coat into the kitchen, which is exactly what it looks like when I am home. Put on my apron here. As we're going to go into really culinary medicine, how to think about food and how to not be intimidated with, even if we go to the grocery store and we see ingredients, but how do those ingredients transition from being ingredients to being a meal that we serve and we have as dinner? Also, the overwhelming aspect of how to cook endless meals, how to make snacks, how to keep our family hydrated. And I think we've all been noticing much more than ever before that we've, as a society, we've gone so much to eating out and getting takeout food that we now can't do these things. And now there's this added load and this added task that adds a lot of stressor. So what I want to do today is really help you learn the why. So why do we want to put the time and effort into this? And then the how to do it as well. So Michael Pollan, he works at UC Berkeley, and he does a lot of work around food. And one of his most famous quotes is, "Eat real food, not too much, mostly plants." And if we can think about that and remember that with every time we're putting food into our body, we would be half to more than halfway there as far as really optimizing our health. Before we get started, I want you to understand, so what is culinary medicine? So culinary medicine is the blend of the science of nutrition, so knowing what effects foods and food-like substances have on the body, either good or bad, and then the how. How do we take those foods that we know then improve our health and turn them into delicious meals that happen to be good for us? As I start this, I always want to make it clear, I love delicious food. So when we think about eating healthy, it's not that eating healthy often has the stigma of being sterile or boring or bland. I always think of My mother-in-law is British, and forgive me on the sentence I'm about to say, but man, she would boil broccoli to death. And she would help me out when we had young kids, and I'm seeing these vegetables just being neglected and just losing their flavor and losing their nutrients. And to realize that's not the way to highlight vegetables. She's come a long way. She moved to California. She's learned the beautiful ways of California eating. And that's my goal for you. So often when we think of healthy, one of the things that can come to mind is overboiled Brussels sprouts. And there's even a smell that it has when it does that. And to realize if you make Brussels sprouts grilled or roasted, it's completely night and day. And roasting vegetables can bring out a flavor in a beautiful way, but we're going to get into that in a little bit. As we think our way through what our plate is supposed to look like, meaning what am I going to choose to put? We're going to cover the basics. And this is a really good visual to kind of just get in your head. You can actually get this online. And this is a Harvard Healthy Eating Plate. And what they did is they took the information from the myplate.gov and added a lot of information to add the science, the evidence behind it. So if you look at the plate, half of it is vegetables and fruits. So whole left side of this plate, we have vegetables and fruits. And that's the goal, is that with every meal, you have either vegetables or fruits. It doesn't have to be both with every meal. Then we have on the upper right, we have the whole grains. So thinking about whole grains rather than processed grains. And we're going to explain, I'm going to tell you what that is so you understand a little bit better. And then the lower right side is healthy proteins. And we think of, I like to use the term well thought out proteins. So ideally, if we can start moving to days where we have plant-based proteins like beans or lentils or tofu or edamame, they're so rich in fiber and nutrients, and they're much better from a cardiovascular standpoint. And it doesn't mean you have to go fully plant-based, but the more meals you add with more from the plant kingdom, the higher your nutritional component is going to be on your day-to-day. And then on the upper right, we see a glass of water. So we want to think about hydrating our body on a day-to-day. And thinking about when we look at the government plate, there's essentially dairy there. And to realize what we need is calcium. We don't need milk. And there are ways to get calcium through those leafy green vegetables, especially nuts. Your cruciferous vegetables like broccoli have a lot of calcium in it. So the sense that we need to have 3 glasses of milk a day is really outdated, and there's a lot of movement towards really thinking about healthier pieces. So when you're drinking, you want to make sure that you're drinking water to hydrate and really being careful about not drinking your calories or not drinking loads and loads of sugar. I really don't like to talk about calories too much. I really want the goal to have these broad strokes of looking at this plate and thinking about this. And if we use this as our guide to make food enjoyable, to not make it like an enemy between us and the food choices that we're making. So really thinking about hydration with either unsweetened tea, unsweetened coffee, or mainly water. And then on the upper left, we have healthy oils. So when we think of what we're going to cook with, the type of oil that we use makes a big difference. And one of the things I'm going to be showing you in a little bit is if I make my own dressing at home, I get to choose the type of oil that I'm using. I'm choosing if there's going to be a sweetness in it or not, rather than the factory who made the dressing. And often when we buy store-bought dressings, the oil that they use is pro-inflammatory. It's not healthy for our body. But if we use other oils like olive oil or canola oil or avocado oil, it actually decreases inflammation of the body. So by learning simple things like how to make your dressing, you are moving already your health in a better direction. And then the last part of this is a good reminder on the lower left, a reminder to move our body, which we talked a little bit about earlier, but it's just a good reminder to get our body moving around on a regular basis. So what is a whole grain? So when we think about whole grains, there are 3 parts to the grain. So there's the outer husk, there's the germ, and then there's the endosperm. So the husk has a lot of fiber in it. The germ has vitamins and minerals and healthy oils in it. And then the endosperm really doesn't have much nutrition in it at all. But when things move from having whole wheat flour, as an example, to white flour, the husk and the germ have been removed, and all you're left with is that starchy endosperm. It makes beautiful flour, And initially, this was fantastic because the endosperm, if you just have that, it actually has pretty much an endless shelf life. And in the World Wars, it was a perfect way to get calories. It's one of the few times, again, I'm going to mention it, to essentially be able to feed the masses, to be able to store these grains in silos, the starchy white flour, and then to make breads with them. But the crazy part is they started seeing vitamin deficiencies that hadn't been seen for over 100 years, something like beriberi, where it's these basic vitamin deficiencies. So they started putting two and two together that there was something missing in that grain. But sadly, instead of going back to the whole grain, we now decided to fortify with added vitamins and minerals. And one of the things to realize is anytime you are able to get the nutrients directly from the food, the way it was intended in nature, rather than fortify with adding vitamins or taking supplements or vitamins, it's much better to go to the how nature intended it to be. Your body absorbs it better and is able to use those nutrients in a much better way. The other part about processed foods, so we use now this endosperm, which is used in a myriad. So we have our white rice. We'll talk about white rice in a little bit. Actually, I'll talk about it now. So white rice essentially is brown rice where the husk has been removed. So if we can get a great way to start moving, if you're a household that eats a lot of rice, is to start eating brown rice or red rice or black rice, or just kind of moving it. The darker the color, the higher the nutrient content. If you have family members that aren't willing to even try brown rice, you can do a combination, and that slowly reacclimates the palate to get used to the more nutritious aspects of brown rice. So when we think of processed foods, it's not just the grain aspect, it's also what else goes into it. So if we think of the processed food aisles, the problem with packaged food is the goal is to be able to have a long shelf life. So the use of these processed grains, plus to add flavor, we often add a lot of sugar, especially if it's a low fat or no fat product. And luckily, we've learned a lot and come a long way of realizing that not all fats are created equal. We also know that there's very little fiber in those foods, very little micronutrients and phytochemicals. And those are really giant words, but essentially it's telling you that there's not much nutrition in it. And your body needs those nutrients. So you have the ability with every time you pick up your spoon or your fork to make a choice to really improve your health. What we're going to do now is make our way through that healthy eating plate and look at how that can look from going to the grocery store or the farmer's market or however we're acquiring our ingredients and realizing what are choices that we can make and what can we prepare to really optimize our health. In this picture, you can see that there is a graph. On the y-axis, we're looking at blood sugar rising in our body. And on the x-axis, which is a horizontal line, you're looking at time. If we look at first the red curve, in the red curve, we're thinking, okay, I'm running late for work. I'm going to go through the drive-thru. I'm going to get a donut and a sugary coffee. Or thinking about feeding, if we have children or choose ourselves, sweetened milk. If they don't like regular milk, often families feel that they have to go to flavored milk to get that calcium. And that's one of the things that I want to reiterate is the sense that we need calcium. And we'll talk about different ways of getting that. But if somebody has, again, milk with a sugary cereal and maybe a cup of orange juice, what does that do? So we're now in the red graph. Our blood sugar goes up very quickly, and our body actually sees our elevated sugar almost as a poison. So it's going to do everything it can to get it out of our bloodstream. And so essentially our pancreas releases insulin, and it puts that blood sugar into our muscles and into our liver. And what's interesting is it overshoots a little bit. So our blood sugar actually goes down below where it was originally, and pretty quickly, within an hour, hour and a half, we're already dipping. So what happens? As an adult, we have a hard time concentrating. We're now looking for the next, see if anyone else brought donuts. Maybe I can grab another one or just start peckishly snacking. We have a really hard time concentrating on, especially on tasks that take more of our brain power. We often start really taking care of tasks that kind of there's this the first in, first out, and this forgetting what is our main big goal for the day. Same thing with kids. They've actually looked at kids who have these sugary cereals and a really hard time concentrating, staying in circle, being able to participate in school. So that is something we're trying to move away from, and we really want to move towards the opposite. So if you look at the other curve, the yellow curve, so if we have, for example, a a breakfast that's much more balanced. You're going to have this rise in sugar, and depending on the person and medical history that they have, the sugar may rise differently. We need that to get energy, but the goal is to do it in a way that's much less spiked and that it lasts for much longer. So ideally 3 to 4 hours. So that's where now you've had breakfast, say at 9 a.m., gets me to noon at lunch. Then I have a lunch that also gives me the adequate nutrients and then the right combination. And then that leads me to dinner. And then if we have times in the middle where we're feeling peckish or hungry, then to do a snack that also gives us a little bit of energy boost with nutritionally dense food rather than calorically dense food. Before we go into more details about the type of cooking and how to shop, why should we cook? Not just because we watch a lot of Top Chef or cooking shows. That's not a reason to start cooking. And also to realize we don't need to be that fancy when we're cooking, to realize we're trying to give ourselves and our loved ones delicious food and really nurture their body. And they've looked at studies, and people in countries where people cook more tend to have much less rates of obesity. And also we see this, especially in places like Europe, where people tend to spend more time cooking. And we're not talking hours, we're talking less than 30 minutes of cooking a day compared to our country. And the rates of obesity are very, very different. The second one is children who are involved in the kitchen, especially from a young age, they start being much more involved with food and realizing the flavors of ingredients and being much more willing to actually try green foods that they may not otherwise, because if there's any involvement, and any involvement could be you have a three-year-old who tears the lettuce, or you can get tools that actually help so you're not worried if you're a parent that now you're giving sharp knives to your kids. So for example, they carry plastic knives. Often if you've gotten cakes, like for a birthday party at work, they have these plastic knives that often come free when you get your cake. Those are really good ones to have in your household for a child. There's also these fun ribbed, not sharp ways to cut vegetables, which are also a really fun way to get kids involved in the kitchen. But again, the goal of you listening to this is not for you to get on your, wherever you buy your stuff, and buy a bunch of equipment. The goal is just to realize that there are ways to involve kids in the kitchen from the beginning. And when you do that, to think, it's also removing that sense that the person who does the ingredient acquisition, and meaning the grocery shopping, or wherever the groceries come from, and then that person often is the one that then goes in the kitchen and is completely separated from the rest of the household. So the rest of the household may be doing homework or watching TV, and now becomes this task or this extra work that needs to be done. But what if instead we bring it together? What if a child does have homework to do and they're doing the homework on the kitchen counter while somebody's cooking? So they're hearing the cooking process, they're seeing it, or ideally even having the child do what's appropriate for their age, and then talking about the ingredients, having them taste with you and starting to know what different flavors taste like and smell like, because that starts making a big, big difference in what they choose to eat. And also it's a great way to catch up at the end of the day. That's often is for us that have kids, the sense of when do kids talk about their day, especially as they get a little bit older. Often we're driving a car or going on a walk, in the kitchen when they're chopping or talking is another great stream of consciousness time in a kid's life, and as a family too. So essentially the point is, instead of feeling separate, like, oh, they get to watch TV and I have to go cook, why don't we come together? Another way to do it, if you have more than one child, is saying, okay, one person helps with prep one day and the other person helps with dishes. So that's a divide and conquer kind of situation. And for them to learn, because they're gonna leave the household one day. And if meals always appeared for 18 years and now they have to be self-sufficient and they never learned culinary literacy, which is that ability to take ingredients and transition them to meals, that it's a lost day-to-day task that has really been lost in our country. And also, if we eat meals at home, and especially if we cook them, there's much reduced risk of diabetes also. So at this point, often people say, well, what if I'm already diabetic? Or what if I already have extra weight on my body? Am I a lost cause? And the cool part is, within 2 weeks of people transitioning to eating real food, we start seeing changes even in blood tests and blood pressure, and even weight starts coming down. But even before that, because people get frustrated that that scale takes a little time to go down, people start feeling less inflamed, like in their joints, they feel less achy, they feel more energy. So it's really cool to see how quickly the body responds to being fed real ingredients. So now thinking about that plate, thinking about the drink. So really our goal is to think about how do we hydrate our body on a regular basis. When shutdown started and we all started living under, over each other, there was a sense of, okay, we need to drink. And in my house, at least, there started being cups all over the house, which was driving me bananas. So one idea that has really helped a lot of people is creating a hydration station. So essentially a pitcher of water, cups. And in our house, we actually bought cups that are different colors when we were on a trip, and each person has their color. If you can't find it, you go on a walk. That's a little bit of movement. Go find your cup, come back, and that's your cup for the day. But also making water interesting. A lot of people, the reason they drink soda or juice all day is because they don't like the taste of regular water. So thinking about how to make that interesting. And I'm gonna show you in a little bit how to make, we think of spa water or flavored water, and how that is completely different than if you are having juice. And to make sure that we touch base, the reason that juice is concerning is because to make juice, it takes 8 oranges. And I have to do this because it's about this much to be able to carry 8 oranges to make 1 cup of orange juice. So what's taken away to make that juice is all the fiber. So yes, you're getting vitamin C, but you're also getting this giant jolt of sugar that then affects our body. So it's better to peel an orange and have an orange. And for hydration, doing things like spa water or infused water, which again, I'll show you how to do that in just a bit. Going back to the whole grains, this idea of how to start getting comfortable with cooking whole grains. Whole grains take longer to cook, and I'm gonna show you a really easy way to make one grain that really doesn't take very long. Also, getting in the habit of batch cooking. How can I cook a couple whole grains on a weekend, and then they last in the refrigerator up to a week? So you do your hard cooking on a day that you're home. I shouldn't say hard, but time consuming. There might be more dishes that day, there might be more pots and pans, but if the oven's on, I'm gonna use every rack to roast vegetables. On the stove, I'm gonna cook a couple whole grains that then I'll store in clear containers so I can see what they are, and then use those to prepare meals throughout the week. So essentially my efforts on a weekend will reap benefits the rest of the week. And again, if you're a household that loves rice, transitioning to brown rice, red rice, a lot of times people say, well, I can't eat grains because I'm gluten-free. There are over a dozen grains that are naturally gluten-free. And to realize that there are ways to get that information, I'm happy to share that information with you as well. And to get in the habit, the beautiful thing is they cook like pasta. You can put a lot of water in there, you put the grain in there, cook it for the amount of time that the package says, and then you just drain it out, and that's it. And then you can use it in different ways. And another good one is if you're a pasta-loving household, transitioning to whole wheat pasta. And often people say, well, I don't like the texture of it. So if you get fusilli, like different shaped pastas, or if you do spaghetti, get cappellini, which is the thinner one, it doesn't have as much of that kind of gritty taste that some people don't like of whole wheat pasta. And again, combining some white and some whole wheat pasta is a great way to transition people who are not used to that change in flavor. Next, we're going to talk about what are ways, when you go to the grocery store, broad strokes of what to look for. And the goal is not to overwhelm you. So these are great 3 aspects that you can look at when you're grocery shopping. And I often, and especially initially when I started really having my eyes wide open of what was being made by factories and what are ways that I could stop that process. So I almost feel like when I go to the grocery store, it's me against the big grocery store makers and becoming an informed purchaser. So the 3 pieces I want you to think about is, number one, if you are buying cereals or meal replacement bars, look at the back of the box. Before that, remember, the front of the box is an advertisement. They're trying to get you to buy this product. So they're gonna say low fat or gluten free. And sometimes there's no rhyme or reason why they're telling you this, because they might tell you that corn kernels are fat free. Well, all there is corn kernels. So again, they're trying to sell it to you, and they use any buzz of what's going on in our world around us. So the most important thing is turn that box around and look at the ingredients and the nutritional label. It can get really complicated, so I want to simplify just a few things that you can do. So if you're buying cereals or meal replacement bars, you want your grams of protein plus your grams of fiber to be more than your grams of sugar. I'm going to repeat that again. Your grams of protein plus your grams of fiber should be more than your grams of sugar. This is a really good thing to teach if you have kids that are 8 or 9 and above. So they want their cereal, just say, okay, it needs to fit this criteria. Number one, they will be reading labels and labels and labels. So it'll entertain them at the grocery store, but it also helps you realize there's only a few cereals that actually fit this criteria. And the take home is, maybe cereal is not the best idea to have a nutritional breakfast. Also, there can be these idea that granola, for example, can be really healthy. So if we use this criteria, you'll notice that often it's filled with a lot of sugar. So this is a really good one to use as a for children as well as adults. The second one is if you're buying something like bread, you really want to see the word whole wheat or whole grain. Buzzwords like multigrain or 12 grain may have some of those grains, but they may all be processed and you're using the buzzword. So you want each slice to have ideally greater than 5 grams of fiber, but at least 3 grams of fiber per slice. The last of the three take homes, if you're buying something like yogurt, yogurt is a fantastic source of probiotics, which are the healthy bacteria that our body needs to be healthy. And you want to make sure that it is plain yogurt that you're buying. Plain yogurt will have about 10 grams of sugar. That's natural sugar. Part of the lactose process and the yogurt making process will have the lactose. If you buy yogurt that's flavored, like even vanilla or strawberry or really any flavor, often there can be 20 to 35 grams of sugar per cup. So it's much better to buy plain yogurt and then you are the one that decides and you get to add the sweetener that you want. Ideally get to a point where your palate loves things like berries, which is what nature intended to be the sweetness that our body should want, or even a drizzle of honey or even some jam. You most likely, most of us will add much less sugar than the company will add. So again, becoming an informed consumer and you having control in aspects like sugar, being one of the biggest ones. Now, when we talk about eating the rainbow, it's really key. The beautiful thing is the different colors that you eat will give you different nutrients. And you don't need to memorize, oh, I have bad eyes, so I need orange food, or I need antioxidants, so I'm gonna do purple. You don't need to memorize that. That's the beautiful thing. If you eat different colors and also from different parts of the plant, your body's gonna get the nutrients that your body needs. And something like blueberries that we often know are really healthy for us, but the price point could be higher. So some people say, well, I can't afford that. But realizing we can buy purple cabbage and it's going to have some of the same health qualities that the blueberry does. So again, purple foods will have the same nutrients. So eating the rainbow, not only does it look beautiful, but your body's also getting all the different nutrients that it needs. Now, when we think of a better breakfast is, again, finding ways that are foods that don't skyrocket our blood sugar and give us much more steady increase and steady keeping of energy and the blood sugar until we get to our next meal. So I'm going to show you how to make something called overnight oats. And that is a great, easy, easy thing that you could do. Again, on a Sunday, you could make several of these to really help your body. But in these pictures, you can see different examples of how to incorporate either vegetables or fruits or both, even in your breakfast. So the one on the left, we have granola. And when you're at the store, you can actually find some granolas that fit that criteria that I just showed you. And I'm just going to say it one more time. So grams of fiber plus the grams of protein should be more than your grams of sugar. So once you find a brand that fits that criteria, or even better, make your own granola. But here we have granola, some plain yogurt, and some berries. So I'm hitting some of those marks from different parts of that plate. Or sliced fruit. It is amazing how kids and adults are much more willing to eat fruit that's cut up rather than even if you have a platter in the middle. And then thinking about we always eat with our eyes first. So making things look pretty. So that middle one, all it is bananas and strawberries, but laying them out, fanning them out. Usually this is gone within 30 seconds to a minute in my household. And then the one on the right, that's avocado toast with eggs. Eggs is a great source of protein. And to realize we don't need to have 5 eggs a day, you know, a few during the week is fantastic. Avocado is a great source of protein. And there we have that whole grain bread on the bottom. So again, hitting different markers from that plate. And then when we think of our meals, often in the United States, we've gotten used to the plate just being filled with a giant piece of protein, often steak. Like if you think of a steakhouse, that's literally all they give you, and maybe you can buy a side here or there. And this idea of the protein flip, so making your protein your condiment, essentially, instead of the main part of the plate. And same thing, it goes with that idea of if you're going to have steak, it doesn't mean you can't have steak, but making it a quarter of the plate and the rest being from the plant kingdom. Often with patients, I say, well, either themselves or they have a spouse or kids that they love their meat and they have to have their meat. So what about using what you would have used for the money for four steaks if you have a family of four and buying one steak? And the rest of the money you're going to spend on those vegetables, on the whole grain, and then making, for example, stir fry. So you're still getting that flavor of that meat. Or tacos is another really good one. You're still getting those flavors, the herbs, the spices that you love, but now you're getting much more from the plant kingdom and it's actually a lot less expensive. So this idea of healthy being expensive moves to realize that that's not the case. Again, beans and lentils being a fantastic source, tofu, edamame, nuts and seeds also have protein in them. So those are all really good ones to think about. The last thing before we move away from the protein flip is the sense of when we think of transitions to make with our food, there's almost this idea of red light, yellow light, and green light foods. And red light are processed meats. So we think of our deli meats, bacon. Those have actually been shown to be a carcinogen. So they increase our risk of cancer. So you're better off if you roast a turkey breast or a chicken breast and then slice it really thin if you still want to have sandwiches or what we would consider essentially sandwich meat. That is a movement in the right direction. Also, if we're going to do red meat and we're spending less money because now we're buying one instead of four for a family, if you get grass-finished or 100% grass-fed beef, which does tend to be more expensive, but having that less frequently, already there, because the animal has eaten grass its entire life rather than corn, the fat that's within the beef itself is actually anti-inflammatory, not pro-inflammatory. So even there, we're still having our red meat, but the type of red meat makes a big difference as far as the health qualities. Another idea of this flip that we talked about, the protein flip, is this dessert flip. And when we think of your typical dessert at a restaurant, for example, and you think of a cheesecake, and maybe it has one or two strawberries on top, often laden with the goo. I'm not even quite sure what they put on top. What if instead we switch it around and it's a big bowl of berries with maybe one or two truffles or maybe a small piece of cheesecake or a brownie or otherwise? Often when we get to dessert, we're already full. We've already enjoyed our meal. We don't need more food, but we want kind of that bow at the end of a meal to just tie it up and just feel like this is a glorious end to a meal. And the dessert flip is a great way to think about that. And I'm going to show you a really simple way. And again, as we're home more and not able to eat out more, one way that doesn't even require any cooking. So here are a few examples of what it can look like to eat the rainbow. So on the left is actually a salad that was made with children and looking at the rainbow salad. So look at all those beautiful colors and really highlighting the beauty of the produce. And noticing that each one of those is going to give you different ingredients and different nutrients. The middle one is what I call the kitchen sink salad, where using, again, the different components of making a salad, something that can be a whole meal, and you're hitting those marks in your healthy plate. And then the one on the right is roasted vegetables and kind of that idea of the protein flip. So this is roasted mushrooms and roasted Brussels sprouts, and then some cheese grated on top, which is giving you some protein. It's giving you the salty umami flavor that we get from especially hard cheeses that have been aged. So it's saltiness and depth of flavor, and you don't need to riddle it with cheese. Notice it's not covered with just laden with melted cheese all over it. It's just that peak of flavor and color that we're going for. And as we finish up here, the goal is to remember to slow down and wake up your senses around food. So I want you to just take a minute and look at this picture from this vineyard. This is actually a picture that I took when I was in Canada, where my husband's from. And I want you to just take a moment. So just a picture, close your eyes and think about this is the middle of summer. And it's heading into almost fall, but not yet because the leaves haven't changed. Think about who is the farmer that grew these grapes. How much sun? What does the sun feel like on those grapes? If you touched them, would they be warm? If you came early in the morning, you can see some of those leaves still have a little bit of dew on them. Who is tending to these grapes day by day? Who is making sure that they're pruned just right to get the perfect grapes for you to be able to snack on or to maybe one day become delicious wine? And think about then, if you plucked one of those grapes, you looked around, make sure no one's looking as you're walking through the vineyard, plucked one of those grapes, what would it feel like in your mouth? What would the texture be like on the outside of that grape? Would it be warm still from the sun? How different would that be if that grape came from the grocery store and had been in the refrigerator section? Now you're going to bite into that imaginary grape. And can you picture, even right there, even if you don't have a grape, most of us have eaten grapes, and you can picture that flavor, that burst of flavor when we first bite into it. And what if with that same grape, we made sure that we chewed and chewed and chewed and see how does the flavor change from the first time I bite into it compared to the 20th time? Is there some acidity that comes through? Is there some sweetness? Does the flavor change as maybe it has seeds in it and now I'm biting those seeds? And again, just stop for a second and think about somebody grew the food that you eat every day. And where you choose to buy your food, how you choose to treat that food, what food you choose to put in your body helps your body, it helps that farmer, and it helps you overall move your health in the right direction. So if you did have your eyes closed, you can go ahead and open them now. And I just encourage you, it doesn't have to be with every grape that you eat, but once in a while to really pause and think about the road, the journey that that ingredient took to get to your plate. So as we finish up here, I really want you to think about your starting point. As I mentioned earlier, I want you to just let what you learned, what you heard today, to just marinate, no pun intended. And think about what feels like the best starting point for you. And that could be choosing, maybe I'll make a dressing and use that throughout the week. Maybe I will choose to incorporate more family members into the cooking. Maybe if you have teenagers, to assign them a day of the week where they need to cook for the household. And thinking about, instead of you're giving them something to do, you are giving them a life skill or a spouse. And realizing that nurturing the body, nurturing your household, is truly helping your immune system, your stress levels. It's helping you need your doctor less, which is kind of funny to say that as a doctor myself, but that is my goal, is to empower you to be able to improve your health with every time you pick up your spoon or your fork. As we finish up today, I want you to remember then to eat well, move your body, connect, breathe, and sleep. Thank you so much. It has been a pleasure. Know that here at Sharpery Staley and at Sharp, we are here in multiple different ways, and things have looked very different. Televisits are an incredible way to seek out your doctor and to remember that if you need medical care, we are here for you. Don't be scared that the place may look different. We will give you the care that you need in a really safe way. And if you're encouraged, I tend to give these tips on social media under Sensation Salud, and it's really my way to continue this journey of awakening your senses around food and really optimizing your health. Thank you so much. I'm Dr. Sabrina Falke with Sharpery Staley Medical Group.